going through a very difficult time. And in life, difficult period, so many times teaches us so many things with which we are not generally comfortable. This is absolutely new experience for me. And same thing with you also. So before I start, a request to everybody who is either seeing me or listening me, please keep one ball pen and your writing material with you. So during your previous classes, during your previous lecture, you might have been taught various alpha agonists. Today, we will see what are the various pharmacological aspects of various alpha blockers. Have a ball pen in your hand, have a writing pad on your table, and please write. Let us see the classification of alpha blockers. Generally, it is classified selective, non-selective, that is selective by default means alpha 1 antagonist. Non-selective means it will block both alpha 1 and alpha 2, and selective alpha 2 blocker. The classification will be like this. So let us see, there are number of drugs in every group. At undergraduate level, I don't think we are supposed to remember all agents. So under the category of selective alpha 1 antagonist, we will see some of the commonly used agents. Number one, prazosin. Second one, tamsulosin. Third one, terazosin. Fourth one, indoramine. Next one, eropidil. Indoramine and eropidil, in addition to their capability to block alpha 1 receptors, have some actions on H1 and 5-HT receptors. Even though these two drugs have some actions on 5-HT and H1, in number of textbooks you will see that these two drugs are considered as selective alpha 1 antagonist. Now in non-selective alpha blockers, again there is a long list, but because of some different reasons, at undergraduate level, it is not necessary to remember the long list of non-selective alpha blockers. In that group, we will consider only two drugs. One is phentolamine and second one, phenoxybenzamine. The third category only one drug we will consider, that is selective alpha 2 antagonist, that is yohimbine. No major therapeutic uses of this drug, that is yohimbine, but as it can selectively block alpha 2 receptors, some of the actions can be encased in the form of some therapeutic uses which we should consider not as a labeled use. During your general pharmacological class, you might have been taught what is labeled use and what is off-label use. So I don't think I should touch that aspect again. Otherwise, we will not be able to complete today's class in a stipulated time. Now, first we will see the various pharmacological properties. This group of drugs inhibit the vasoconstriction induced by exogenously given as well as endogenous catecholamine leading to vasodilatation. Now this vasodilatation naturally will result into fall in blood pressure. Both resistance arterial and veins will be dilated because of this actions of alpha blockers, which can lead to decrease in peripheral vascular resistance. Now this decrement in peripheral vascular resistance can lead to a fall in blood pressure. Now naturally, this fall in blood pressure, when it is there, body tries to oppose it, and this can be because of either sequelae or consequences of reflex stimulation of sympathetic nervous system via baroreceptor reflex mechanism. So this fall in blood pressure is very, very important. Now this fall in blood pressure will depend upon the value of sympathetic tone. Listen carefully, this fall in blood pressure will depend upon what is the existing tone of sympathetic nervous system at that particular time. Suppose, due to any reason, if sympathetic tone is more, there will be more fall in blood pressure. Other way around, if sympathetic tone is less, there will be a less tendency to fall blood pressure. Blood pressure will fall to a lesser extent when sympathetic tone is low. Now this is extremely important. This pharmacological property, unless we know it, we will not be able to understand one of the very, very important ADR of this group of drugs, which we will see when we will discuss the ADR. Now, as we have seen, this fall in blood pressure is opposed by baroreceptor reflex. That will be able to help to maintain the blood pressure. Now, this reflex stimulation of baroreceptors mechanism will increase in the heart rate and cardiac output. Now, during your lectures of general pharmacology, you might have been taught the concepts of various autoreceptors. You go back to that lecture, you remember what is the functions of autoreceptors. Now, autoreceptors, when they are stimulated, they inhibit further release of neurotransmitter. Now, at undergraduate level, alpha-2 receptors, both pre-junctionally and post-junctionally, have been accepted as autoreceptors. So, why there is tachycardia with this group of drugs? Now, naturally, these reflexes are suppose if these alpha-2 receptors are stimulated, there is inhibition, further release of norepinephrine. But what we are doing here, we are blocking these receptors. So, inhibition of these alpha-2 autoreceptors will not take place. So there is further release of norepinephrine, because the basic functions of this alpha-2 receptor is to inhibit the release of neurotransmitter. So when this process is inhibited, So there is further release of norepinephrine. So this further release of norepinephrine will increase the heart rate. Now this is extremely important. Now, alpha-1 receptor blockers inhibit the increase in blood pressure induced by sympathetic agents. Any sympathomimetic agents, we will see the further some differences, but this alpha-1 receptor blockers will inhibit the increase in blood pressure induced by different sympathomimetic agents. Now, type of response of these agents depend upon which sympathomimetic agents we are using. This is extremely important. So, there is a long list of drugs, sympathomimetic drugs. At undergraduate level, it is not necessary to know what are the different types of response which can be blocked by alpha-1 receptors. So, just we will see three responses. Suppose if we are using phenylephrine. During your previous classes, you might have seen that phenylephrine is a selective alpha-1 agonist. So naturally, very, very easy, when we are using selective alpha-1 antagonist like prazosin, it goes without saying that response of phenylephrine, what will be the response? Increasing the blood pressure. Increase in the blood pressure because of phenylephrine, which is selective alpha-1 agonist, will be totally or completely blocked by this group of drug, that is selective alpha-1 antagonist. Is it clear? You please write down these three important differences. Number one, that is phenylephrine response, whether increasing the blood pressure will be totally blocked by selective alpha-1 antagonist. Now comes adrenaline. Very, very important. In your terminal exam, in your prelim exams, even in university exams, you can have so many times, if you go through the various question papers, you will be asked, explain what is Dale's vasomotor reversal. Now, adrenaline if it is given, naturally you have seen various types of actions of adrenaline which are dose dependent, and when there is how it is given. If it is given as a bolus injection, whether it is given as an infusion, whether it is given in high dose, whether it is given in low dose. So, response of adrenaline is converted into depressor response means, suppose if you give adrenaline and it is preceded by phenylephrine, what will happen? If you give adrenaline, it will slightly increase the blood pressure, which you have been taught by our faculties. Clear? Now suppose, if this adrenaline is preceded by phenylephrine, what will happen? This phenylephrine will block the alpha-1 receptor action of the adrenaline. Adrenaline will act on so many subtypes of receptors. Alpha-1, alpha-2, beta-1, beta-2. Forget about that. Now, this alpha-1, alpha receptor and beta receptor are responsible for raise in the blood pressure. Right? Now suppose if it is preceded by phenylephrine, it will be converted, the pressure response of adrenaline will be converted into depressor response. This is called Dale's vasomotor reversal. Is it clear? Dale's vasomotor reversal. Now, what is Dale's vasomotor reversal and why it can take place in the body? At undergraduate level, it is not necessary to go into further detail, but you can remember that this Dale's vasomotor reversal, that is stimulating response of adrenaline, is then converted into depressor response. During experimental pharmacology practical, you will be taught, but presently you can remember that this depressor response is because of more sensitivity of beta 2 receptors to low dose of adrenaline to beta 2 receptors in comparison to other receptors. Is it clear? Clear? Now, in experimental pharmacology, during your practical of experimental pharmacology, there will be a biphasic response. Biphasic response means when you give adrenaline, because of its actions on alpha receptors and beta 1 receptor, there will be raise in blood pressure. Clear? Beta stimulation of beta 1 receptor will produce positive inotropic and positive chronotropic. Means force of contraction will be more, increase in the heart rate will be more, so that will produce rise in blood pressure. Clear? Now, after some time, as adrenaline is metabolized, its concentration in the plasma will fall gradually. Fall. And at some point during this process of falling, the concentration of adrenaline will be very, very low in the plasma. Now, just before few minutes, we have seen that beta 2 receptors are more sensitive to action of adrenaline. Now, where are these beta 2 receptors situated? You imagine. Where are these beta 2 receptors are situated? Number one, you will come into mind will be trachea and bronchi. But here we are not concerned with the trachea and bronchi. They are also situated in peripheral blood vessels. Right? Now, naturally, when we produce agonistic action at these beta 2 receptors, what will happen? There is peripheral vasodilatation. Now, this peripheral vasodilatation will lead to fall in blood pressure. Clear? Now, third drug is norepinephrine. Now, can you imagine if you are listening me, I will ask by Girish bhai. My face. So you just concentrate on my hand. You just concentrate on my voice as well as my hands. Now, what will happen? Now, suppose norepinephrine, can you recollect the types of receptors on which norepinephrine will act? Just 3-4 seconds. Norepinephrine will act on alpha receptors. Where are these alpha receptors situated? Peripheral blood vessels, major blood vessels. Second, beta 1 receptors. Where are these beta 1 receptors situated? Myocardium. So what will be, can you imagine what will be the effect of alpha 1 receptors on heart rate which is given by norepinephrine. Means, suppose if we give norepinephrine and it is preceded before, if before alpha 1 antagonists are given, then what will be the effect on blood pressure? It will be incompletely antagonized. Why? You can imagine why? Because norepinephrine will act on beta 1 receptors. So selective alpha 1 antagonist, selective alpha 1 antagonist like prazosin will not have any action on beta 1 receptors. So this beta 1 receptor, which are situated on the myocardium, will be stimulated by norepinephrine and they will be spared. So because of this sparing effect on beta 1 receptors, there will be incomplete, that means there will be slight decrease, but it will not be totally antagonized. This is extremely important, right? So we have seen what are the different types of actions of selective alpha 1 antagonist if blood pressure is increased by, number one, epinephrine, second, norepinephrine, and third one, yes, again you will have to keep in mind, which one? Phenylephrine. Phenylephrine, epinephrine, and norepinephrine. It should be very, very clear. Now, the next pharmacological actions or pharmacological properties, which is extremely important, because this is the action for which this group of drugs are generally used. So, when you go back to your classes of general pharmacology, where are these alpha? There are number of sites of alpha 1 receptors in the body. So, in context of this today's class, alpha 1 receptors are situated in prostate, and those part of ureter which is surrounded by prostate, right? So, that part of the ureter which is surrounded by prostate gland. Now, you can imagine. Now, suppose if we stimulate these alpha 1 receptors which are situated in ureter as well as those part of prostate which surrounds the ureter. Now, if we produce any agonistic action on these receptors, any agonistic, what will be the sequelae? What will be the consequences? Just two, three seconds for you to remember. What should be the consequences? It will obstruct the flow of urine because of two. One is prostate and second is ureter. Clear? Very, very important. This is prostate gland, this is ureter, and if we produce the agonistic action on these alpha 1 receptors of ureter as well as prostate, there is increase in the volume of prostate which will press the ureter, and there will be further obstruction in urinary flow, which is commonly seen in a patient of BH, benign hypertrophy of prostate, BHP. This is extremely important. Now, at undergraduate level, it is sensible not to discuss various minute features of various selective alpha 1 antagonists. So we will consider prazosin as a prototype drug. There is minor differences, very, very minor differences in pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic. As such, in pharmacodynamic, there is no difference. But in pharmacokinetic, there is a difference, and it is it will be a sensible approach on my part if I don't touch those aspects. So, tamsulosin, terazosin, trimazosin, prazosin, they all sail in the same boat. So, what we will see? We will consider only a prazosin. During the classification of alpha blockers, we have seen, prazosin has been accepted as a selective alpha 1 antagonist. But as it is a competitive antagonist, if we further increase the concentration, during your classes of general pharmacology, you might have seen some of the features of competitive antagonisms and its importance in therapeutics. So you again recapitulate. We do accept that prazosin is a competitive antagonist, but when we increase the concentration of agonist, means concentration of epinephrine and norepinephrine, this competitive antagonism can be taken care of. Ideally, I should have brought up on the blackboard, but you were taught in the classes of general pharmacology, and I don't think we should repeat all those information again. So, this prazosin produces fall in blood pressure. Now, during my initial part of the lecture, we have seen some of the pharmacological properties of these alpha blockers. Now, when we give prazosin, naturally, because of its action on both resistance arterial as well as venules, veins, there will be a vasodilatation, right? So, there will be a fall in blood pressure. And we have seen that this fall in blood pressure will depend upon how much it will fall. It will depend upon the value of sympathetic tone. Suppose this is the value of sympathetic tone, and suppose this is the fall in blood pressure. If the sympathetic tone is very high, the fall in blood pressure will also be very high. Right? High means more. Here it should be, it is a common understanding. Suppose sympathetic tone is very high, the level of blood pressure, the degree of fall in blood pressure will be correspondingly more. If sympathetic tone is low, the fall in blood pressure will be low. Means, in one sentence, we can say that fall in blood pressure is proportional to the sympathetic tone. Clear? If sympathetic tone is more, more fall in blood pressure. If sympathetic tone is low, there will be less fall in blood pressure. Extremely important. I have tried to oversimplify. Now the reason for oversimplification is very justified. Now, in therapeutics, suppose if we use prazosin for any clinical condition, for any therapeutic uses, which we will see during the therapeutic uses. Now suppose, if we use a very high dose initially, and in your patient, if the sympathetic tone is very high, there are 10 reasons for more sympathetic tone. Again, absolutely needless to enumerate all, but just remember a very relevant example. Now, in a patient of hypertension, suppose if we are using diuretics, any diuretics, what is the long list of action? So, again, we will not go through those actions. Number one is diuretics have tendency to produce fall in blood pressure. Clear? Very, very important. They will try to fall in blood pressure. Diuretics. Clear? Now suppose there is fall in blood pressure. So what body has been given by Almighty? When there is a fall in blood pressure, there is tendency to increase in the sympathetic tone. It is a natural mechanism provided by Almighty. Clear? So, suppose if prazosin is used in a high dose with diuretics which can produce fall in blood pressure, which will increase the sympathetic tone, what will be action? Now you remember what I have said just before 10-15 minutes. What I have said, that degree of fall in blood pressure depend upon the level of sympathetic tone. If there is sympathetic tone is very high, the fall in blood pressure will be abrupt and very, very high. Degree of fall in blood pressure will be more. So what will happen? There is sudden fall in blood pressure and patient will collapse. Patient will collapse. So this is known as first degree phenomenon. This is known as first degree phenomenon. The most important thing to avoid this first dose phenomenon is, again there is a long list, but we should at undergraduate level we should concentrate only one or two. Number one, if we want to start prazosin, always start with a low dose and gradually increase the dose. Gradually increase the dose. So during this gradually increase the dose of prazosin, what will happen? There is slight fall in blood pressure, body, there is slight sympathetic tone will this. So we will take care of this homeostatic mechanism. Very, very important. So no drastic fall in blood pressure. Clear? Now, very unfortunately, you are not sitting here. If you are listening me, if you are saying me, just one question, you are try to answer. Just you will be given 4 to 5 seconds. Now suppose if we give prazosin will produce fall in blood pressure. Clear? Now fall in blood pressure more often than not is generally associated with reflex increase in the heart rate. Agree? Anybody who is listening to me or seeing me can answer whether this fall in blood pressure will be associated with reflex increase in the heart rate? Yes? 4 seconds, 4-5 seconds. Answer is no. Why? Why there is no increase in the heart rate? Alpha 2 receptors are autoreceptors. So what will happen? Prazosin does not have any action on alpha 2 receptors. Right? So there will not be any action. Right? So there is no effect on alpha 2 receptor, thus there is no release of norepinephrine. Now we will see the different therapeutic uses of Dinesh bhai, 4.5 thai to mane kejo? Kitla thaya? 36, 36. Okay. Now let us see the therapeutic uses. Now, number one, hypertension. Even though it is number one, that it should not go to your mind that this group of drugs are a very popular antihypertensive drugs. There are some other uses. And when we compare this use as an antihypertensive, they are more used. Let us see some of the important informations or aspects related to antihypertensive or therapeutic use of this class of drug as an antihypertensive agents. Nowadays, they are not used as antihypertensive agents because of number of reasons. Again, at undergraduate level, it is not necessary to discuss all those reasons why they have lost the popularity as antihypertensive agents. But the number one reason is because of availability of superior antihypertensive agents. They have lost the popularity. Before 20 years, before 25 years, 30 years, they were used. Second is first dose phenomenon. Sometimes not the patient, but even the clinicians might be ignorant of the mechanism of this first dose phenomenon, and unknowingly they may be responsible for abrupt fall in blood pressure. I have seen before 30 years in my family when one of the clinicians prescribed prazosin during this before 30 years, when I was in pharmacology, I was knowing no sooner one of my relatives took this prazosin, after just 2-3 hours, immediately collapse means throbbing headache, pulse. We were not able to take the pulse, profuse sweating. When I checked the prescription, one of the drugs was diuretics, hydrochlorothiazides. Unfortunately, I am not able to remember the dose of this hydrochlorothiazide, but it was almost 40 to 50 milligram. I am not sure. And the first dose of prazosin was very high. Head was kept low. One pint was given. And ultimately, it took almost 12 hours to patient to recover from that. So, this is one of the very serious consequences. Now, as an antihypertensive agents, this class, this cadre of drugs do have some advantage over some other advantages. Number one, on metabolic advantage, means this group of drugs, this group means specially naturally selective alpha 1 antagonists, they improve the various lipid profile of the patient during the chronic use. That means they don't have significant deleterious effects on triglycerides, LDL, and they have some favorable actions on HDL. So, this ratio of LDL to HDL, this ratio of triglyceride to HDL, and even independently, put all this LDL, triglyceride, and HDL, there is a positive change. But very, very unfortunately, during number of clinical studies, it has been proved that chronic use of this group of drugs, that is selective alpha-1 antagonist, cannot increase the lifespan of the patients of hypertension. This is the most important limitation of this. Now, next therapeutic use. It is dangerous to use this drug for diagnosis of pheochromocytoma. Let us see some of the absence of this group of drugs in a patient of hypertension because of pheochromocytoma. Now, naturally, pheochromocytoma is a malignant condition of the adrenal gland, especially the medulla. Now, what happens? There is tremendous release of epinephrine and norepinephrine. Right? Now, suppose in an inoperable condition of pheochromocytoma, sometimes the condition is such that surgeon cannot operate. So here, the drugs like prazosin can be given. We will see when we will see the non-selective alpha-1 antagonist. But here, this alpha-1 antagonist is very useful drugs, right? And we will see how they can be very cautiously used because of in the hypertension because of pheochromocytoma. When we will discuss the non-selective alpha-1 and alpha antagonists like pentolamine and phenoxybenzamines and other drugs, right? But today, just you will see that they can be used. Now, in the textbook which you are reading, you will see, I don't know, it is given in the textbook which you are reading, that it is used for the differential diagnosis of pheochromocytoma. How it can be useful? Just have 4-5 seconds and try to understand. See, pharmacology is a very volatile subject. If you don't remain in touch, in the very first class with your batch, I have very clearly said that pharmacology is a very volatile subject. Unless we are in the touch with the subjects, all things will be evaporated. So off and on and on, very frequently, very repeatedly, we will have to be in contact with the subject as we are in contact with our loved one. Otherwise, there is every chances of evaporation. Just have 5 seconds. Now, suppose it can be of some help like this. Suppose if it is used for differential diagnosis of hypertension. Hypertension may be on one side, it may be because of, it may be essential hypertension, and it may be hypertension because of pheochromocytoma. Now suppose if you give these drugs, tomorrow we will not see this when we will see the non-selective, because it can be discussed at a time. I think I should not discuss it today. Just now we will see this action tomorrow, right? Differential diagnosis. So next therapeutic use is congestive heart failure. Now, congestive heart failure, again, during classes of cardiovascular system in second term or due term, you will see the various areas related to CVS. Now, congestive cardiac failure during your 10 years, during your first MBBS in physiology, you might have been taught different types of cardiac failure. Congestive, decongestive, forward, backward, right? So, in congestive cardiac failure, we will not go into physiology, applied physiology. or even in pathology you will be taught. But what happens in congestive cardiac failure? Now, if suppose cardiac failure is there, if heart is failing, body has tendency to stimulate the sympathetic nervous system. Because of this stimulation of sympathetic nervous system, body will be able to perfuse various vital organs. Because of this reflex stimulation of sympathetic nervous system in a patient of cardiac failure, what will happen if we stimulate the sympathetic nervous system? There is increase in cardiac output, increase in force of contraction, increase in heart rate. Clear? If you are able to see my hands, well and good. But you can just listen if you are not able to see. Clear? Now suppose, if there is increase sympathetic nervous system, there will be increase in force of contraction of the heart that will perfuse the vital organs and patient will be able to survive. Now, this will produce the beneficial effect. But at the same time, what will happen? At the same time, because of this stimulation of sympathetic nervous system, there will be a release of epinephrine and norepinephrine. So you might have seen some of the receptors. What are the receptors which will be acted upon by norepinephrine, epinephrine? Alpha receptors. Alpha receptors of peripheral blood vessels. So when this endogenously release catecholamines acts on the alpha receptors on the peripheral blood vessels, there will be a vasoconstriction. Now because of this vasoconstriction, the blood supply to the vital organs, heart, brain, kidney, liver, lungs will be compromised. So there, this selective alpha-1 antagonist will be useful. Very, very important. Now next therapeutic use, benign hypertrophy of prostate. Now we have seen that this selective alpha-1 antagonist will act on the alpha-1 receptors of prostate and ureter, which is surrounded by prostate gland. So they will decrease the resistance to the flow of urine. Patient will be able to pass urine without any difficulty. But in this context, in therapeutics, these drugs, selective alpha-1 antagonists like tamsulosin or terazosin, are combined with drug like finasteride. You will be taught during the endocrine system what is this finasteride. So what is finasteride? Basically, finasteride inhibits the conversion of testosterone to dihydrotestosterone. Thus, the volume of the prostate will be decreased. So combination of tamsulosin plus finasteride is more superior than the monotherapy of either drug. Monotherapy of either drug means either tamsulosin or finasteride. If they are given separately, then this will not be. I think I should stop here. Tomorrow we will discuss the other things. Right? So, it is a request. This difficult period, stay safe. If possible, don't leave your home, don't leave the place where you are reading. Take care, all follow all the instructions given by the government. Take care, being a medico, It is your moral as well as professional duty to take care of not only yourself, but of your surroundings. Good luck.